Where did this virus come from? It's crucial we understand this so we can avoid it happening again. Well, everybody's got a theory. It's wet markets, it's bat soup, it was made in a lab, it's 5G. Is there any truth to any of it? Let's do some fact checking. Let's see what actual scientific evidence there is. We're gonna focus on the ideas that have become more mainstream. Otherwise, this video is gonna be longer than The Irishman. There's nothing like a pandemic to bring out the conspiracy theories. The World Health Organization had to come out and explain viruses don't spread by 5G. And if we look at some of the worst hit countries like Iran, for example, they don't even have 5G yet. In fact, they made a whole myth-busting page, including such gems as, if I can hold my breath for 10 seconds, does that mean I'm virus-free? Does taking a hot bath help prevent COVID? And does spraying chlorine all over my body kill the coronavirus? Okay, let's look at some of the most well-accepted ideas, like, did the virus originally come from a wet market? This study in The Lancet looked at 41 of the first confirmed cases in China. Two-thirds of those patients had contact with the Wuhan wet market. But let's take a closer look. Here's a breakdown of the patients by date of diagnosis. Those who had contact with the market are in pink. Blue is no contact. So the very first case they report had no link to the market. The next cases only pop up 9 days later. Of the first four, only one was linked to the market. This doesn't exonerate wet markets, but it's certainly not a smoking gun either. It's possible the market played a role in spreading the virus. Maybe one of the first infected people went there, contaminated stuff, and then that place became a focus of infection. Or maybe it did start at the market, but the first few cases were asymptomatic, so the virus kind of covered its tracks. Also possible. Plus, these markets were implicated in SARS back in 2003, so they do have a certain track record. But to say that the virus definitely emerged there, that the wet markets are the cause of the pandemic, if we're being objective, we don't know that. So this idea that the solution is to just close these wet markets and problem solved, no more pandemics, that's not true. In fact, there are many outbreaks that have nothing to do with Chinese wet markets. MERS came from camels in the Middle East. Swine flu was, of course, from pigs, and it started in the US. Are wet markets a factor? Probably. Is getting rid of them a panacea? Does it solve all our outbreak problems? Probably not. It's psychologically comfortable for Westerners because it puts the blame over there. It's something they have to sort out. And there's some cultural relativism too. If only they would stop eating those weird animals. This isn't just internet noise. A US senator claimed China is to blame because they eat bats and snakes and dogs. So, did we get COVID-19 by eating bats? There's this whole thing with bat soup. What does the evidence say about that? It is true that bats are probably the reservoirs of several viruses, like SARS and MERS, according to bat researchers. That's a pretty cool title. I bet they all have the same license plate with the same joke.
I'm Batman.
So, did we get COVID-19 by eating bats? According to analysis of the genomic sequence, there is a virus in bats that is 96% identical to SARS-CoV-2, the human virus. But it has some fundamental differences that suggest it doesn't bind efficiently to the human receptor that allows the virus to get into our cells. So, the bat virus is a very close cousin, but it's different enough to not be infectious per se. This other study agrees that direct transmission from bats to humans is unlikely, and there are probably intermediate hosts transmitting SARS-CoV-2 to humans. So, getting COVID from bat soup or eating bats in any other form, not supported by evidence. Okay, but maybe the bats gave it to another one of the weird animals, and that gave it to us? This genomic comparison predicts that pangolin, cat, cow, buffalo, goat, sheep, or pigeon could all be the intermediate host, together with civet or swine. So not exactly a smoking gun. I mean, they got the whole Noah's Ark in there. So theoretically, it could be a cat or a cow, which means we have no reason to specifically point the finger at wet markets and the weird animals over there. For all we know, it could be a bat in the wild that gave it to a goat or a sheep, which gave it to us. Don't get me wrong, I have no love for these places. It's not like this video is being sponsored by the Hunan wet market. There are plenty of reasons to dislike them. Animals crammed into cages, horrible conditions. This should not exist in 2020. And they may very well have played a role in SARS and maybe even COVID-19. But if we want to figure things out and be taken seriously, we have to be objective. And saying that we just take out the wet markets and the pandemics go away like a miracle, they go away. If we're being objective, we're being honest, we don't know that. Okay, but one thing seems clear. COVID is zoonotic. We did get it at some point from an animal. Not from a lab, it's not man-made. That's another idea out there. And here are the Nature Medicine authors. Our analyses clearly show that SARS-CoV-2 is not a laboratory construct or a purposefully manipulated virus. So we can put that idea to rest, not based on the evidence. So we know it's natural, we know it's zoonotic, and let's face it, is anybody really surprised? We have outbreaks of zoonotic viruses all the time. I mean, it's one after the other. We had SARS in 02, swine flu in 09, MERS in 2012, and now COVID-19. And that's just the A-listers. We also had dengue in 2010, Ebola in 2014, Zika in 2015. iPhone models don't come out this regular. And that's just the last 20 years. Coronaviruses alone, we've had three major ones in 18 years. So it's pretty obvious this will happen again. And all the experts in infectious disease seem to agree. From this Cell paper, it's straightforward to predict that more coronaviruses will emerge in the future. It's not if, it's when. This realization that zoonotic outbreaks are a recurring problem has led to another idea that's being floated out there, that it's all because of factory farms. Now, let's apply the same standards we used for the wet markets. Factory farms are horrible, at least as bad as the wet markets, and arguably worse. We complain if we can't leave our comfortable homes for a couple months, and yet we trap intelligent creatures in tiny cages for years. And besides the ethics, factory farms are an ecological nightmare and a health hazard. Keeping animals packed like this, lying in filth, probably is a petri dish for microbes to evolve. And some outbreaks are directly tied to factory farms, like swine flu. Awareness of the problems with factory farms has been growing, and COVID-19 has been a big catalyst. Many recent articles on the issue, and Bill Maher had a segment on this that went viral, no pun intended.
Americans should not get too high and mighty about wet markets while we are doing this.
So we can all agree that scaling down these factory farms would help with a lot of things, including these outbreaks. It probably wouldn't solve all our pandemic problems by itself, but like the wet markets, it's a factor. We have to face the fact that treating animals like trash for our convenience, whether it's in Chinese wet markets or Western factory farms, is creating enormous problems, both for the environment and these infectious diseases. Okay, what's the solution? How do we change this? As much as we talk about legislation and activists exposing the conditions inside factory farms on social media, at the end of the day, there's really only one way to change things, and that's to not buy their products. They're businesses, and the bottom line for them is supply and demand. That's simple. For some people, this may mean eating animals they raise themselves, or raised in a small farm they know personally. For others, it will mean transitioning to eating more plants and getting your protein and your iron that way. And I've made many videos about that, and this one summarizes everything you need to know. And we have to accept that different people will transition differently, at different paces. We're not all the same. And honestly, any step away from this is positive change for all of us. And if you're thinking, there's nothing we can do, factory farms are massive multi-billion dollar corporations. Things can change very quickly, and giants can be toppled. Just ask dairy. In fact, factory farms are already hurting. Some of their largest plants have shut down because of the virus, and millions of animals are being killed and thrown away. This is a tragedy at so many levels. But with every crisis comes an opportunity. And if we play our cards right, maybe when Tyson and Smith Field come back to business, maybe we won't need them anymore. And maybe we can start turning the page on this ugly, ugly chapter of human history. And the employees in those facilities are victims too. And our job as a society is to support them and help them transition to other industries. In addition to looking at how our food is produced, we'll also need to invest more on medical resources and research. We humans suffer from collective amnesia. Every outbreak generates a media storm, everybody panics, then it passes, and we forget it ever happened. Until the next one hits. I've heard from world experts who were trying to develop a SARS vaccine back in 2003. As soon as the pandemic died down, people lost interest, the funding dried up, and they had to abandon the projects. Now here's SARS Part 2, the sequel, hitting us like a ton of bricks, and we're scrambling for a vaccine again. You don't lock your doors after the burglar is already inside the house. Now, of course, they're not the same virus, SARS-1 and SARS-2. But by developing a vaccine against one of the members of the family, inevitably, we learn a lot and become better at it. Also, sometimes vaccines cross-react. In fact, one idea is to develop an umbrella vaccine that targets several coronaviruses, ideally the whole family. Not only would that save our butts right now if we had it, but 6 years from now when the next little bastard comes along, we'll be ready. But that requires investment and foresight. Science grants aren't the cheapest thing in the world, But a few million will support a state-of-the-art lab for years. We just spent $25 billion to bail the airlines, $2 trillion total as a result of COVID. But we don't have a few million to prevent the problem in the first place. It's a complete lack of vision and planning. If you fail to prepare, prepare to fail. So the truth is, there isn't one simple answer, one magic bullet. I'm all about simplicity. It's the name of the channel. But just like climate change, these pandemics are global challenges, and as such, they'll probably require intervention at multiple levels. That's three major factors right there. That would go a long way. Can you think of some other ones? By all means, pitch in. Let's brainstorm. Here's the good news. These problems are all connected. Animal agriculture is also a factor for climate change. So every step towards sustainable eating and sustainable living helps prevent these outbreaks and also helps the environment. Two of the major existential threats we face as a species. So we have massive power in our hands to change things. In the grand scheme, COVID-19 is a big speed bump. Let's hope it wakes up the driver.